Chapter 1. One day, Kohli's mom tells her she has to find a husband now that she's an old maid of 13. Kohli lives in India, and everyone gets married young, plus it will really help her family out. We get some backstory about Kohli's bap, aka dad, and ma, aka mom. Her bap is a scribe in the local market square, which basically means he writes letters for literate people. Ma does what all the other women do in their town, she keeps the home in order. She cooks, cleans, and embroiders linens with fancy designs to make some extra money for the fam. It's clear that Kohli's family doesn't have much money, so Kohli finding a husband will mean there's more food to go around for Ma, Bap, and Kohli's two brothers. Here's the catch though, finding a hubby will also be tricky since Kohli's family doesn't have much to give for her dowry. As the family starts hunting for a suitable husband who will agree to marry Kohli, her brothers tease her that no one will ever want to marry her. They're just joking, of course, but Kohli wonders how much she's worth. Her brothers go off to school each morning, but she has to stay home and help her mom. When she asks to go to school too, her ma tells her it'd be a waste, girls don't need to go to school, she says, because they do work at home. Pretty soon, Kohli's parents have found her a match. He's a Brahmin, translation, the highest Hindu caste just like her. His name is Hari Mehta, and he has a sister, which makes Kohli happy since it means she'll have help with the chores. For her dowry, Kohli's parents sell some of their own wedding presents from back in the day, as well as their cow. As if that's not enough, the Mehtas also ask about jewelry, so Kohli brings along her mom's heavy silver earrings. Kohli says goodbye to her brothers and heads to the Mehtas' place with her parents. When they get there, Mr. Mehta isn't interested in anything besides the dough. He's all, show me the money, about it. Kohli is bugged by how little anyone cares about her in her new family. She meets her sister-in-law, Chandra, who is younger than her and much prettier. Later that night, Kohli overhears her parents talking about the marriage. Her ma is worried that none of them have seen the groom yet. Sure, Kohli isn't supposed to until the wedding, but why is he hiding from her parents? Ba replies that Hari's sick with the flu and resting for the big day. Kohli considers running away but knows that would bring shame to her family, so she decides to stick it out, figuring the Mehtas will grow to love her eventually. The next day, Ma wakes Kohli up to get her ready for the wedding. Her parents are a little emotional, but Kohli's ready. As she walks down the aisle, she sneaks a peek at Hari and he's much younger and sicker than she guessed he would be. But what can she do now? She goes through with the ceremony and ties the knot. It's time for wedding cake, including Kohli's favorite, coconut cakes. All the men eat first, though, and by the time she gets to eat, there are no coconut cakes left. Sigh. Kohli can tell that her parents are ticked about Hari being so young and frail. As they say goodbye to her, they tell her he's not what they expected. Still, though, her mom reassures her, saying Hari will grow big and strong in no time. Bap slips his daughter a coconut cake he saved for her. After they leave, Mrs. Mehta tells Kohli she'll sleep in Chandra's room since Hari is sick. Then she instructs Kohli to hand over her precious silver earrings for safekeeping, a home, to sell them. Kohli refuses and goes to her room. Instead, she finds a loose brick in the wall and stuffs them in the side so no one steals them. She feels like a caged animal, all alone, trying to figure a way out. Chapter 2. Kohli gets up early the next morning to start her chores. Mrs. Mehta, aka her sass, instructs her on what to do throughout the day. Her life is beginning to sound a lot Cinderella's. Kohli has to wash the dishes, do the mopping, get water from the well, if it's a chore, it seems like it falls to her. After a while, Mrs. Mehta leaves to get Hari's medicine, telling Kohli not to bother Hari while she's gone. Except Kohli doesn't like being told what to do one bit, so when she hears Hari coughing, she goes into his room to check on him. Hari looks very pale and thin in bed, but she talks to him anyway. He tells her about flowers and bugs, he has quite the collection. She remembers her mom giving her honey and ginger when she had a cough, so she makes that for her new husband. His cough goes away for a little bit, and Kohli asks him if he's really has the flu. Nope. No, he does not. In fact, he's really sick with tuberculosis. Not for much longer, though, since his parents are taking him to the Ganges to cure him. Hari, however, hopes that he will die there and his body will be laid to rest in the magical Ganges. Okay. Suddenly Mrs. Mehta returns. She scolds Kohli for bothering Hari, but he stands up to his mom, saying Kohli brought him something for his cold and is actually hanging out with him, so leave it alone. Mrs. Mehta isn't exactly happy about this, shocking, we know, but she leaves Kohli to do the rest of her chores. Later Kohli asks Chandra why her parents would let Hari get married if they knew he was so sick. Chandra explains that the family needs money, so they let Hari marry Kohli so they could pay for the trip to the Ganges with her dowry. Ouch. Kohli hopes she can at least go along too, but Chandra is sure they'll have to stay at home, the train ticket is too expensive. That night Kohli hears Hari arguing with his parents. He wants Kohli to come with them to the Ganges and doesn't see why she can't. Chandra tells Kohli that her brother always gets his way because 1, he's the only boy and 2, he's sick. It turns out that Chandra's right. After a while, Mrs. Mehta calls Kohli in and tells her that she will get to come along on the trip. The only problem, The doc visits later on and tells them it's not such a good idea to go to the Ganges at all. The travel will be tough on Hari. Mrs. Mehta doesn't listen, though. She knows this trip will heal her son and tells the family as much. Kohli notices that Mr. Mehta just follows whatever his wife says. Chapter 3. Bright and early the next morning, they get ready to head off to the Ganges. Kohli says goodbye to Chandra and wishes for a moment that she could stay behind with her new sister, they'd have so much more fun without Mrs. Mehta breathing chores down their necks all morning. Chandra asks Kohli to put a garland of marigolds on Hari for her if he doesn't make it. Hari is carried out to the wagon and fanned on the train, but he still gets really weak from the journey. When they arrive in Varanasi in the afternoon, Mr. Mehta's colleague Mr. Lal and his family invite them to stay. Everyone is anxious to get Hari to the Ganges, but he's too weak to go on, so instead they give him some of the water to drink. Kohli watches closely as he chugs the water, expecting a miracle to happen. The only thing that happens, however, is that Hari begins coughing more violently than before. He's sent to bed to rest. The next morning, they head off to the Ganges and let Hari walk in it. Kohli takes a deep too. Hari jokes around with her about floating, and she thinks that he has the same humor as her brothers. She notices that Hari seems stronger in the water, and hopes for the best. He's so weak after his swim, though, that he has to be carried home. Once at home, Hari hacks and coughs so much that they call a doc to come see him. Alas, Hari's even weaker than before and there's nothing anyone can do. Mrs. Mehta and Kohli cry together. Even though Kohli hasn't known Hari for a long time, she wants him to get better and worries about him. That night Hari dies and Mrs. Mehta wails. Mr. Mehta comes to see Kohli and apologizes for letting her marry their son when he was so sick they needed the money for the journey and really thought it would help Hari. Kohli realizes that she can't go home to her parents because she's already been married and no suitor will want her. But she's also not married anymore. The girl's a widow at 13. The funeral for Hari is held, and Kohli puts a garland around his neck for Chandra just like she promised. Hari's ashes are scattered by the Ganges at least, which is good luck. Mr. Mehta promises they will take care of her, and on the way home, Mrs. Mehta buys her a cheap white sari that widows wear. Chapter 4. Back at home, Kohli finds her new way of life exhausting. She is responsible for more chores than before, and Mrs. Mehta is always mean to her. Why? Mrs. Mehta is grieving, and she's mad that Kohli's dowry didn't save Hari, now they just have another mouth to feed. After a couple of weeks, Mrs. Mehta takes Kohli into town and asks if the government has anything for her son's widow. Kohli doesn't get it. What does that mean? Mrs. Mehta tells her it's just a formality and not to worry about it, but Kohli knows better. They're given a bunch of forms, but since Kohli can't read, they mean nothing to her. Kohli begins to quilt to pass the time. She embroiders Hari at their wedding and starts to work on different scenes of their time together. She can tell that Mrs. Mehta likes looking at the images, even if she also scolds Kohli for wasting time quilting. Chandra loves Kohli's quilting and loves to watch Kohli work. The two of them become bosom buddies, spending loads of time together and confiding in one another. Kohli thinks Chandra is a little spoiled, and Mrs. Mehta never gets mad at Chandra the way she does at Kohli, but they are still friends. Chandra means well. One day Kohli wanders into Hari's old room and finds his bug collection all dead and dried up. She notices his book is still in there, though, and wishes she could read it, so she asks Mr. Mehta to teach her. He's reluctant and doesn't want Mrs. Mehta to find out, but he promises to teach her each morning while Mrs. Mehta is out the house. Kohli can hardly contain her excitement. She even tells Chandra how lucky she feels. Even though Chandra is happy for Kohli, she's not interested in reading. After all, her parents are looking for a husband for her, so she doesn't need to know how to read. Kohli starts working with Mr. Mehta on reading, and pretty soon she's taking the book everywhere she can to practice. Mrs. Mehta finds out that Kohli has been learning to read and scolds them for it, but Kohli doesn't care since, she can finally read. Sometimes Mr. Mehta comes home from teaching school frustrated. When Kohli asks him about it, he explains that his students mock him and prank him all the time, putting scorpions in his desk and hiding his glasses so he can't see. Mr. Mehta wishes all of his students were as eager to learn as Kohli. Mr. Mehta reads one of Hari's favorite poems aloud and Kohli misses him. After a while, Kohli begins to pray for Krishna to let her escape from the Mehtas. Shok Chandra is nice to her and she gets help from Mr. Mehta every now and again, but Mrs. Mehta hates her. Nothing Kohli ever does is good enough for Mrs. Mehta. Though there are some fun times, like when Mrs. Mehta takes them to a festival or Mr. Mehta lets them out to dance in the rain, most of the time Kohli is stuck working herself to the bone. Kohli remembers learning that Krishna was naughty as a child, so she decides to become naughty too. Her best work, putting a frog in the drinking water and pulling out all the plants instead of the weeds. You sure am Kohli. She's careful never to spill any salt though, since her mom told her that if she does she'll have to clean it all up in the next life. No thank you. Chandra wants Kohli to be careful, Mrs. Mehta won't put up with that behavior for long, but Kohli doesn't care. That woman's already so mean to her, this is just Coley's way of taking a little revenge. At this point she's been living with the Mehtas for 2 years, which, fun fact, means Coley is now 15. Then one night, Chandra tells Coley that her parents have found her a husband. Chapter 5. The Mehtas talk to an astrologer to find out when would be the best day for Chandra to get married. And they decide on January 2nd for the big day. Chandra is more excited than ever to marry Raman, who works with computers. Coley heard her dad talk about computers once, so she knows they must bring home the dough. She's excited for Chandra, but she wonders whether her sister-in-law will be happy. What if they are not a good match for each other? Chandra explains that so long as she's a good wife, Raman will be good to her. Coley's not so sure it's that simple, though. When Mrs. Mehta instructs Coley to hand over her silver earrings for Chandra's dowry, Coley refuses. She's already planned to use them to buy herself a train ticket to run away. That night Mrs. Mehta tells her husband how wicked Coley is. She's just so selfish to keep those earrings for herself. Mr. Mehta reminds his wife that they are using Coley's pension for being a widow to pay for Chandra's dowry in the first place, so maybe don't do anything rash. Coley is shocked to hear this, that money belongs to her. When she asks Chandra about it, her sis is surprised too, she had no idea. Chandra worries that without that money, she won't have a husband. Even though it's not Chandra's fault, Coley is still mad. She's not going to take that money away from Chandra, but she won't give up her earrings either. Coley tells Mrs. Mehta that her widow's pension is to come to her next time it arrives, but Mrs. Mehta points out that they let her live there and feed her, so the money is theirs. Ouch. This isn't fair, but there also isn't anything Coley can do about it. Chandra asks Coley to make her a quilt for a wedding gift, and Coley obliges. When it's done, it's so elaborately embroidered that even Mrs. Mehta admits it's beautiful. By the time the wedding rolls around, it's been 3 years since Coley married Hari. Coley wants to help Chandra get ready, but Mrs. Mehta won't let her because of tradition. During the festivities, Coley recognizes how different this is from her wedding. Everyone is happy and celebrating, and there isn't a sickly groom and frightened girl at the altar. Chandra and Coley say goodbye to one another through tears. When Chandra tells Coley she'll miss her the most, Coley realizes all her happiness is vanishing. Chapter 6. Things go from bad to worse once Chandra leaves. Mr. Mehta is depressed because his son is dead, his daughter is gone and he's disrespected at work. Yeah, that's a heavy load to shoulder. They get electricity at the school and start installing computers. It's great for Mr. Mehta's students, but he doesn't know anything about this sort of thing and becomes useless. No one respects him. Most nights he comes home from work and sits in his room, depressed and chanting prayers. Mrs. Mehta continues to find fault with everything Coley does, even when she does it right. Coley decides she won't be mischievous anymore, and works really hard. Somehow, though, this only annoys Mrs. Mehta more. Food is getting scarce, and some days Coley is so hungry she's dizzy. One day she sees a stray dog and decides to make him her pet. She bathes him and gives him table scraps when she can. Of course Mrs. Mehta is livid when she finds out. When the dog chases down a goose, she beats him, but he runs away with it still in his mouth and never returns again. Next up, Coley tries her hand at taming a bandicoot. Before long, though, he senses the depression in the house and gets the heck out of Dodge. On her way to town one day, Coley has an idea about her pension and asks the guy that Mrs. Mehta took her to see if she can pick up the money herself. He tells her that's not how it's done, but if she moves somewhere, she can have the money sent to her new address. This gives Coley another idea. She'll use her pension and the earrings to live for a little while until she finds a job. It's risky, since at least with the Mehtas she has a roof over her head and some rice. Still, though, Coley is determined to go. Then one day Mr. Mehta comes home early from school. We're not told this, but we can guess that he was fired. He goes into his room, rolls up his mat, and dies. Chapter 7. After Mr. Mehta dies, Chandra is called home for the funeral. The girls are excited for time to catch up, but they don't get much since Mrs. Mehta is too busy parading Chandra around to all of her friends and barking orders at Coley. You know, as Mrs. Mehta does. Chandra tells Coley that her husband brought a computer and a TV home for them. She tries to explain the wonderful images and colors she gets to see. She confides in Coley that she wishes she had learned how to read, like Coley suggested. When her hubby types on the computer, she doesn't know what the characters mean on the screen. Coley notices that Chandra wears expensive clothes, gold bangles, and even has her toenails painted. Seeing her sis like that makes Coley think she can be happy one day, too. When Coley shares with Chandra that she plans to run away one day, Chandra tells her not to do it. Who will take care of her? Coley plans to take care of herself, thank you very much, but she doesn't bother saying this to Chand. Ra. Chandra leaves after a week, and Coley keeps herself busy with the chores. Without Mr. Mehta's paycheck, Mrs. Mehta starts selling everything to feed them. When she goes to sell her husband's precious book of poems, though, Coley begs her not to, it was his favorite after all. Coley makes a bargain with her mother-in-law, she'll get her silver earrings and Coley will keep the book for herself. It's not until after she hands over the earrings that she realizes this was Mrs. Mehta's plan all along. One day misses. Mehta gets a letter from her brother in Delhi saying that she can come stay with him. When Kohli asks where she will go, Mrs. Mehta says she'll come along too. Mrs. Mehta buys the train tickets for them with the money from the earrings. Even though Kohli hasn't had a happy life during her 3 years there, she is said to leave the house. They board the train and get off at the holy city of Vrindavan. This isn't their destination, but Mrs. Mehta suggests they get some air and a bite to eat. They take a rickshaw to a temple, and Mrs. Mehta argues with the driver about the 4 rupees he wants to charge them. She sends Kohli off with a 50 rupee note to buy some lunch, which Kohli thinks is weird since usually she's not trusted with them. Only, when Kohli gets back with their samosas, though, Mrs. Mehta is nowhere to be found. So she waits. An hour goes by and then another, until finally Kohli decides to ask around. She comes across the rickshaw driver, who tells her that Mrs. Mehta boarded the train to Delhi right after he dropped them off at the temple. With this, Kohli realizes she's been ditched. Chapter 8. Kohli thinks about how foolish she's been. Mrs. Mehta didn't want anything to do with her, so of course it was only a matter of time before she got rid of the extr. A mouth to feed. The rickshaw boy is named Raji and tells her that many people dump their widows in the city. Nice. Most of them end up chanting prayers in the temples all day, and the monks give them a little bit of food so they don't starve. Kohli wanders the streets looking for a place to stay. Soon she figures out that she doesn't have enough money to pay for room and board, so she finds a house where she can stay for free, on the porch. She heads to the government office to see about her widow's pension, but can't get it without an address. Guess what else she can't get? An address without her money. Let the good times roll. Kohli figures she'll have a life of chanting in the temple. This doesn't exactly excite her, though, so she decides to head to the train station and look out for Mrs. Mehta. She knows her mother-in-law isn't coming back, but she wants to go just in case. At the station, she sees Raji and asks him about what she should do. He tells her that he'll take her to a woman later in the day who can help, but Kohli's not sure she believes him. He also tells her to be careful, there are lots of dangerous people in the city. Later, as Kohli's waiting for Raji to return, a man comes up to her and offers to give her a pretty saree. If she comes with him. Wink wink, gross gross. Kohli remembers what Raji said and tries to get away from the man, but he grabs her arm. She bites down on him as hard as he can, and he slaps her before running away. When Raji finally returns at the end of the day, Kohli is relieved to see him. He takes her to meet a woman named Ma Kamla, who lets widows live with her. She's a plump woman with a round waist and an even bigger heart. She introduces herself to Kohli and tells her that she can get a job in the bazaar. It's tough work, but someone has to do it. Kohli is so excited that she hugs Ma Kamla. Chapter 9. Kohli likes her new place and friend Tanu. Each morning, Ma Kamla wakes the women up and hurries them off to work. Kohli shares a room with Tanu and 3 other widows. Ma Kamla takes half of their wages to help pay for food and the house, but they get to keep the rest. Tanu already works in the bazaar stringing marigolds onto garlands, so she teaches Kohli what to do. At first Kohli is slow and some of her flowers fall off the string, but before long, she gets quicker and makes beautiful garlands. Their boss is always freaking out about something, like when jasmine is delivered instead of marigolds one day. Kohli suggests they tie the flowers together on one garland, which the client loves and makes the boss happy. Good thinking, girly. At lunch, the girls buy some food in the bazaar and chat while looking at all the stalls. They see a stall with beaded bracelets and wish they could afford one for themselves. The guy in the booth says he knows their boss and hears they do great work, then he makes them a deal. They can string some beads into bracelets, and if they work hard enough, he'll let them each keep one of the bracelets. Kohli and Tanu are thrilled. They work super hard each night after work making the bracelets and show off their own by the end of the week. Most nights after dinner, Raji comes by the house and hangs out. He's saving up to be able to move out of the city and back to his village where his family owns a farm. His parents are dead and he doesn't have enough saved yet, but he will soon. Pretty quickly, he and Kohli become good friends. One day, Raji comes by as Kohli is reading a poem from her book about a homeless bird. Everyone stops to listen to the poetic language, even Raji loves it. When Kohli asks Raji if he wants to read one next, though, he gets embarrassed. He can't read. No problem, Kohli says. She'll teach him in no time. Each night after dinner, she goes through the letters and words with him to help him master it. Sometimes he brings her a sweet treat from the bazaar, which she enjoys, and before long she finds herself thinking about him all the time. Hum sounds like puppy love to us. One day Raji asks her if she wants to go on a walk to a stream about 30 minutes outside the city, away from the hustle. Andy bustle. She's excited to go because it reminds her of her village. She's much happier now, but sometimes the city makes her a little stir crazy. Raji tells her that he will be looking for a wife soon. Kohli doesn't know what to say because she doesn't want to be too forward, but she will miss him if he gets married and moves back to his farm. After that, Kohli doesn't see Raji every day anymore. She thinks she hurt his feelings, but she's not sure why. Ma Kamla announces that the lady who owns the widow house will be visiting soon, so the ladies clean everything up. When Mrs. Devi arrives, she's dressed very plainly. She asks Tanu and Kohli to give her a tour of their room and loves the quilt that Kohli embroidered. In fact, her seamstress friend has been looking to hire an embroiderer, and Kohli is a real artist. She promises to take Kohli to meet her friend tomorrow. Chapter 10. Kohli waits for Mrs. Devi to take her to the sari maker the next morning and is relieved when she shows up. They ride together in a car, it's the first time Kohli's ever been in one. Mrs. Devi tells her the cool air is called air conditioning. As they ride through the streets, Mrs. Devi explains to Kohli that her family, too, was from a village. Her dad was told his mom had died, but she'd actually been abandoned at Vrindavan because she was a widow. After he'd struck it rich inventing and selling a special drill for wells, he left some money in his will for a widow's house to help out people like his mom. A.W. At the shop, Mrs. Devi introduces Kohli to Mr. Das. He figures there's no time like the present, so he takes Kohli for the day to see what she can do with thread. He tells her to embroider something, and at first she just copies the girl next to her. Then he explains to Kohli that he wants her to be original, design something different. She thinks about her walk with Raji and makes a heron similar to the one she saw there. Mr. Das is impressed and tells her what he'll pay her if she works for him. Chachin. It's three times the amount she's been making at the flower shop. Kohli loves her new job. She can't believe how much she's getting paid to do something she loves. In fact, her whole life is enjoyable now. The only thing that makes her sad is missing Raji. Mr. Das is a nice guy to work for. He's very fair and even-keeled, and the only time Kohli sees him remotely upset is when a bridal veil is stolen from the shop. A woman named the Shrew had been embroidering it with gold, so it's expensive. When it's stolen, Mr. Das even hires a security guard to watch the store at night. Kohli befriends one of her co-workers, Mala, who is only a year older than her at 19, which means we now know that Kohli is 18. One day Mala invites Kohli to hang out, but Ma Kamla says she can't go. She's heard gossip about Mala doing some stuff she doesn't want to see Kohli mixed up in. Kohli is livid. Why should Ma Kamla tell her what to do? So Kohli comes up with a plan. She tells Ma Kamla that she and Tanu are going to the movies, but sneaks off to hang out with Mala instead. At Mala's place, Kohli notices the fancy bridal veil that was stolen from Mr. Das's shop and realizes that Ma Kamla was right, Mala is bad news. She turns to leave, but a guy offers her a drink. It's hot outside, so she gulps it up, but before she knows it, she's woozy. Another guy helps her outside and explains to her that the drink was spiked with drugs. Luckily, he then ushers her back to Tanu at the movies. When they get home, Tanu covers for Kohli with Ma Kamla, saying the snacks at the movies made her sick. After Kohli goes back to work, Mala whispers to her that if she mentions anything about the veil, she will rat her out with Ma Kamla. The girls stop whispering because they can tell the Shrew is watching them a little too closely. Kohli feels dumb for trusting Mala in the first place. Chapter 11. Raji is waiting for Kohli outside of work one day, and she is over the moon to see him. Even better, he asks her if she wants to walk to a spot along the river. A.W. They go there together, and he tells her of his life on his land. He's fixed up the house and planted crops so he can make more money. Now that he has everything all nice, he wants to know if she would like to live there as his wife. She's stunned. Sure, she thinks about him all the time, but no one wants to marry a widow. What will his family think? Raji doesn't care about that. He doesn't want to have an arranged marriage and never get to talk to his wife. His parents had that, and it was boring. He wants a wife who he can share ideas with and discuss poetry with. He wants her. Kohli is excited, but she's also hesitant because she doesn't want to leave her new, independent life in the city. She hated the crowdedness of the city at first, but now she loves it. She has her own job, money, and friends, and she's not sure she's ready to give all that up for Ali. Faye doing housework in the country. Of course, Raji's disappointed upon hearing this. He wants them to be together, but he understands that she doesn't want to do chores all day long. Kohli promises that she'll think about it though. She misses him when he's not around, but she needs a little bit more time here first. She and Tanu just moved out of the widow's house and into their own place. Now that they both have steady jobs, they don't need to be with Ma Kamla anymore. They want to make room there for new widows. Kohli and Raji write each other letters so they can stay in touch while she thinks about his proposal. He tells her about trees and stocks that he plants, and she shares what she's doing at work with him. One day, Mala steals some gold thread from Mr. Das and gets caught. She's fired. Kohli is glad Mala is finally gone. Kohli feels like she's ready to go to the country and be Raji's wife when she learns that he's built her a special room to embroider in. He knows that her work is important to her, so he wants her to be able to do that from the countryside. Kohli knows Raji gets her and agrees to marry him. She begins to make a quilt for her dowry again, but this time it's full of joy and love. When the quilt is finished, she and Raji will get hitched. Kohli lets Mr. Das know that she'll be leaving soon. He's upset, of course, but he agrees to let her work from her new home and bring her embroidered stuff by every couple weeks. Now she can have the best of both worlds, the man she loves and the job she loves. Yay! Tanu finds some new roommates, but makes Kohli promise she'll be back to visit. A lot. Kohli is done with the quilt and ready to tie the knot, this time on her own terms. Mrs. Devi comes by her job on Kohli's last day with a request. She wants Kohli to embroider something from one of her favorite poems. Kohli agrees and already knows what she's going to stitch, the homeless bird, flying home. The end.